Shalom. Welcome to the Jewish View. My name is Rabbi Nachman Simon with the Chabados of Delmar, and a very special guest with us today, close to me because he's my son, Rabbi Shruli Simon, came all the way. We can call him an international speaker because he came all the way from Kingston, Ontario in Canada. Welcome, Shruli, to the Jewish View.
Thank you for having me.
Well, actually, this is not the first time. I don't know if anybody has a good memory, but was it 15 years ago, even maybe more? We've been on the Jewish View for so many years. There you talked about Jewish sports stars. So now you're a little bit older, and I'm still 29 years old, of course. But we're going to talk about Jewish life. You can't talk about the whole Canada, but at least Kingston. So first of all, tell us what you are in Kingston, Ontario. I'll tell you honestly, before you went there, I didn't even know it existed. Maybe I'm, you know, ignorant. Maybe more people do know about it. Tell me what the city is and what the Jewish community in generally is like.
Well, Kingstonians think it is the most beautiful city in Canada. So I get lucky for that. Well, it's right on the top of Lake Ontario. It's beautiful summers. The winters are somewhat like here, a little in between. Got nice skiing. But the people are nice. I moved there in about 2 years ago to help service the needs of the Jewish students at the University of Queen's University. Queen's University is considered to be one of the top three universities in Canada, and it historically did not have a large Jewish student population. Though the infrastructure to help Jewish students away from home, most of them, was quite advanced. It had the first Hillel in Canada, and it was supported to such an extent that they had a full-time rabbi, and they used to lend their rabbi for his extra time to the Jewish community to serve as their part-time rabbi.
How many students in general are there?
Well, I like to make a joke. You know how numbers go, that there used to be 1,400 and now they're growing and there's 1,100. So 1,100 sounds with the grad students and the medical residents.
These are Jewish students?
Jewish students.
Out of how many?
Out of about 20,000 total, undergrad and grad. So it's a mid-sized Canadian university. Some of the other universities have up to 50,000 students, you know, some of the bigger universities, but it's growing. They're investing in the infrastructure. They're developing their commerce programs, which is really good, and they're drawing more Jewish students, mostly from Toronto, but the Jewish student population has gone up in the last 7 years fourfold, fivefold.
Very good. How far are you from Toronto?
We're about 2.5 hours east, up the Lake Ontario, and a lot of Jewish students traditionally stayed at home, commuted to school, University of Toronto or York, and the ones who wanted to go away went to the west of Toronto, London, Ontario, Western University, and lately they've been coming to Queens.
Oh, very good. What do they specialize in? And so always university has a few things that they're renowned for.
Well, they have a very good engineering program. Commerce, business degree they have as well. A little of, you know, they teachers college, nursing. They have a very good medical school, which is getting better, and as they keep on investing in the infrastructure, the buildings, the classrooms as such as well, to draw better professors and be able to handle greater classrooms.
And what do you do for the Jewish students? What kind of programming is there now for them?
So there's a whole host of Jewish students. There's some American ones coming to Canadian University. It's cheaper to go to a Canadian private university
really?
Than it is.
I didn't know that.
When you include room and board, it's not as cheap as going to a public university, a state university. But if you were thinking of going to a private university in the States, it'll be cheaper. Tuition will cap out, even for foreign students, at about $10,000 to $15,000. Mm-hmm. And with room and board, you're not going to pay more than $30,000, even for a top university like McGill, as well. So we've got a whole host of Jewish students from a lot of different backgrounds, and university is for most people it's a shock to their system. So we provide a home away from home, just so they know in the larger, as they get lost in their first year of university, and and they're joining maybe Psych 101, which might have 1,000 students in the course, and the TA is in their subgroup of 200 students, so the TA doesn't even know their name, and no one really knows who they are. And as they start to get lost, you know, a lot of them are looking to connect to where someone knows who they are, cares for how they're doing, someplace warm. And if you think about it, you know, a student who came from a home with kids, besides for summer vacations a week, might not see a child for 4 years, you know, besides for, you know, 3 months a year or something. And there's that, a lot of feeling to, that's separate from their Jewish needs and joining the Jewish community, is there's that service that we provide, that we're a home away from home, a family for them.
You know, that's very interesting. I know my wife, who started at the University of Massachusetts also, she's found that a little bit discomforting, just that you see only, obviously, 18 to 22-year-olds. I mean, it's a whole world. There's old people, there's young people, and just to look at one kind of person. And then I know it's, my mother said that she lived in Boca, and again, it's senior citizens' residential homes of her condos, and it's, you know, it's like a mile by a mile, whatever, and there's thousands of, all you see is senior citizens. I mean, something's just disoriented that, I mean, they're not, the world is not just old people, and it's obviously not just college students. I mean, you have a whole world. There's kids, there's old people, there's middle-aged. I guess it's interesting how it throws you off, I mean, psychologically, then. And that's just not real.
And that's something we're looking to capitalize on, not to have that little vacuum where it's just one type of age group, college age students having fun, going to some classes, but to introduce some volunteer programs. We've always already had a challah baking program where the students can take home half the challah they bake, and the second half is donated. It's donated to a youth shelter, to a women's shelter, and the students really like to give back, and they like to participate in the community, to the greater community of Kingston, Ontario. We plan on as well introducing, there's some students who are very interested. They were involved with some programs for special needs children in Toronto, and they'd really like to start a volunteering program as well. Interact with children with special needs, give their parents a break, as well with senior citizens who are in the community, you know, might be alone, you know, shopping might be difficult as well. Just take some time, give to the community, and as a whole, we can always see the healthy and the best effects it has on the student itself.
You know, it's just really interesting. Obviously, the university, I mean, they're there to teach into higher level courses. I mean, that's their main purpose. And they try to have student activities, but for the most part, it really probably is lacking. I mean, they don't interact with the community for the most part. I'm not saying you can't, or maybe there is some little program, but for the most part, it's just, here's your courses, you know, and go home and, you know, go to your dorm and just learn and learn. And they don't teach you really to be a full human being, how to get along with people, or, like you say, help somebody out in the community. You're a more fortunate person. I mean, you're a university person. And, you know, really, in a certain sense, they're elite people, especially on a higher university, but so they tell you, well, you have to give back to the community. No one tells them that, you know, no one teaches them that. It's not part of the coursework. So like I say, just there's other people around, or just even unfortunate people, not just kids and senior citizens. So I think that's a very much of a bigger need. How receptive, though, are they for Jewish activities? I mean, what kind of Jewish background do they come from, and do they take towards the Jewish activities?
Well, the Jewish students come from a whole host of backgrounds. There's a Jewish high school in Toronto, Char, and it has become the number one request from them, not that all of them are going, the ones who choose and are accepted, but to go to Queen's University. It's become the most popular one for those senior class of the Jewish high school. Those who come from the Jewish high school.
For what reason, then?
Change, it's elite, different. It's a good university. Yeah. Maybe parents are becoming more comfortable with having their kids go away from home. It's different. you don't want to do the same thing as everyone used to do, so they're looking for a new place perhaps. And those students have a good, decent Jewish education background, having gone through a Jewish high school. So they might be, in a case, more traditional and more looking from when they start university, from even before they come during Frosh Week, to make that connection. I'm here, what do you have? This is, I want to join the Jewish Weller services, holiday programming, Shabbat meals. They look from the beginning to get involved, volunteer, and join the Jewish student community at Queens. There's another group of them that perhaps went to Jewish camps, but didn't go to a Jewish high school, and perhaps not as well a Jewish primary school. And they might be Jewish-minded as well. If they're coming from Toronto, their families are very likely to be involved with the Jewish community. And they are really looking, you know, they've got their friends, they've got new friends, but they really like the grounded coming back to the Jewish programming, whether it's Shabbat meal, a Purim party, Simchat Torah. And then there's the students from all over, Vancouver, Calgary, Edmonton, the States. Some know a little bit, some know not as much. All of them are, you know, the ones who come and the ones who we find are really interested in learning more than they've experienced. And as one noted speaker once said, that you go to university and you can't just rest on all the knowledge, the high school knowledge you have. You have to continue in whatever field you choose, become greater and smarter, more knowledgeable in your field. So too in spirituality and Judaism, you can't rest on your level of knowledge and commitment to Judaism and spirituality at a high school maturity level. It comes university, there's that need to learn more, study deeper, come to a more mature understanding of what Judaism means.
So it's interesting. Do you have classes like Geared Up? I just know for myself, on a high school level, of course you're on a college level, it's different, but I mean, compare and contrast science and Judaism, how they're complementary. I mean, because you're taking obviously high-level classes, and how Judaism is not, I always found that people just think Judaism is cute and, let me say, childish. You know, Noah's in his ark, that was a nice little story, it was cute when I was first and second grade, but, you know, hey, I'm a sophisticated person, I'm taking philosophy courses on top of everything, science, how does Judaism relate to me? So you can relate that Jewish ideas, because Judaism really is deep. I don't know how much our audiences appreciate that also, because they, you know, the people mostly stop it when they're children or bar mitzvah, which means they're seventh grade, so teachers are obviously not teaching them higher, deeper ideas. And then I'm coming saying that, hey, listen, there's some really deep concepts in Judaism that rivals physics and any philosophy that they're going to learn at the university level.
A body of knowledge of over 2,000 years, which has had deep spiritual and intellectual benefits and aspects to it. And that's something they've probably, as a high school student, never really experienced or knew existed. And we try to do it in our weekly classes. We have tacos and Torah. Gotta feed the body, feed the soul. But also just on a Shabbat meal, when we speak about, you know, the rabbi's lesson, we tend to stay away from a standard lesson about the Torah portion, and we try to focus on something, whether it's a mitzvah or something we're doing at the Shabbat meal itself, and bringing significance, because there's a lot of people who've lived very Jewish lives, very traditional lives, gone to synagogue often with their family, and they don't really know why they do anything, or a lot of it. They know Shabbat meal is a time for family, but why do we wash Netilat Yadayim before we eat the challah on Friday?